Forget Pac-Man fever, there's a new arcade epidemic. Flip Puck has arrived, and it's making parents flip out. More at 11.
This isn't your grandpa's table game, May.
This is Flip Puck. Blast your friends into the danger zone with power shots, ricochets, tap air hockey, half pinball, and all action. Built with mind-blowing physics, crazy bumpers, and the one thing your mom really hates, total chaos.
Triple threat. Those glass bumpers will save you three times. After that, they're history.
Three lives. That's it. Will you earn your place on the high scoreboard or be digitally deleted?
This is Flip Puck. This unholy abomination was the product of four frustrating months and $300, which means it went precisely $300 over budget. So get in, loser. We're going on a nostalgia trip. Let's set the DeLorean to 1994 and visit 10-year-old Matthew. Picture this. It's a Saturday afternoon, and my pops has just rolled up to the mall. My hype level is through the stratosphere, baby, because we're heading to Aladdin's castle. I love everything about this place. I've got a crisp $5 bill burning a hole in my pocket, and I'm ready to go. The first stop was usually Lethal Enforcers 2. We shot Old West bandits in all their blocky, pixelated glory. My dad always won. He had military training, so I never really stood a chance. But oh, then came air hockey, and it was my time to shine. This was a game I could actually win. Nothing beat the whoosh of the puck as it flew across the table. I treated those matches like Olympic qualifiers. Sweat was shed, pucks were slapped, glory was earned. With my last dollar, I'd head to the pinball machines. That mechanical chaos stole my heart. My favorite was Theater of Magic. The flippers, the lights, the drama! I was wallowing in this state of nostalgic nirvana when the idea for Flip Puck popped into my head. I gave it a whopping 30 seconds of consideration, which is practically a doctoral dissertation for my brain, and immediately I got to work. I wanted this to be an actual thing, not just some pixels on a screen. That meant choosing the hardware from the get-go. I had an old 8GB Raspberry Pi 4B that was just collecting dust. Previously, it was running OctoPrint, but my new 3D printer didn't need it. So recycle and reuse, right? Or, you know, just use whatever you got laying around. I'm a Flutter developer in real life, so the Flame game engine was a no-brainer. Not only is it powered by Flutter, but the folks at Bluefire are seriously awesome. I badgered them constantly with questions on their Discord, and they were always super helpful. For physics, I used Forge 2D, which is a Dart port of Box 2D. Flip Puck ended up being way more fun than it had any right to be, and a huge chunk of that credit goes to Forge 2D. It's like the duct tape of game physics. Slap it on and boom, it just works. It almost felt like I was using a cheat code. Forge 2D works best when you've got accurate collision shapes. At first, I was trying to hand code these like an absolute gremlin. Eventually, I realized that there had to be a better way, and I found an app called Physics Editor from Code and Web. This thing is delightful. Import your sprite, hit the shape tracer button, and bada bing, bada boom, bada bobs your uncle, you're done. The only catch is that the Y coordinates it generates are inverted from what Flame expects. I spent a lot of time manually fixing them. It's still better than doing it all from scratch, but Physics Editor does support custom exporters. I might write one for Flame in the future. The art mostly came from abusing my Canva subscription. Yes, Canva. I designed almost everything inside Canva before writing a single line of code. I knew the exact resolution of the screen I was going to use, so I just created a Canva doc that was the same size. There were a few assets I couldn't find in Canva, and a quick Google search brought me to Game Developer Studio. I definitely recommend them. They make high-quality art designed specifically for game dev, and they have assets for almost every genre. I'm not sponsored, but I genuinely do love their stuff. Next up was audio, and holy crap, was that a nightmare. Bluefire recommends their Flame audio package. For a normal game, that's fine, but we're running on a Raspberry Pi, which means we don't have a lot of audio channels to work with. Flame audio just exhausts them almost instantly. Not only was the audio laggy, but the game stuttered like crazy. The Pi just straight up couldn't juggle all those sounds. It was like a DJ trying to mix 50 tracks on a single turntable. What followed was weeks of hacking, duct taping, and primal screaming. My sanity was in shambles. I vented about this to a coworker, and he suggested trying the Flutter So Loud plugin. Now, All my instincts screamed that this was not gonna work. And I was over it at this point. You've heard of vibe coding? Well, this was rage coding. I totally showed my keyboard who was boss during this refactor. And the only reason I even bothered with it is so that I could tell this guy his brilliant idea didn't work. So anyway, So Loud solved all my problems. The audio was perfect and the game ran smooth as butter, like terrifyingly smooth. Like I didn't realize the Pi could run anything this smoothly, levels of smooth. Thanks, buddy. You know who you are. Sorry I doubted you. With a Raspberry Pi back on the menu, it was time to start optimizing. I knew from my previous project, the Decisioninator, that Flutter-Pi was a dream to work with. It's a lightweight engine embedder optimized for the Pi, though it works on any Linux-based system. All you need is the Linux command line. That's seriously it. Getting rid of the desktop environment frees up a ton of resources. With all the software sorted, it was time to work through the hardware. Now, throughout the whole process, I used a Raspberry Pi 400 for development. I soldered some leads to the buttons, hooked them up to the Pi, and by some miracle, it worked on the first try. I wanted a retro 80s synthwave vibe, and a lot of these pictures really capture that. I really liked the glowing strip lights. Eventually, I settled on a color scheme of purple, pink, and lime green. I once again chose Onshape as my CAD software. It's the easiest CAD software I've ever used, and since it's web based, it can run on a potato. My last project went through 14 failed prototypes before I got it right. I wasted enough filament to bury a small country. I really wanted to do better this time, so I designed a lot of test pieces. This approach was incredibly successful. I had some minor plastic waste up front, but it was still better than trying to design the whole thing at once. I printed the case in Galaxy Purple from Bamboo Lab. It fits perfectly with the game's graphics. I even used my fancy 3D effect build plate to add some extra sparkle to the screen bezel, because who doesn't love a little extra sparkle? With all the parts printed, it was time to assemble. The LED strip runs on 12 volts DC, but the Pi needs 5 volts, so I used a buck converter to step it down. The thing I love about this LED strip is the plastic cover that makes it look like a neon sign. I'll never get used to cutting these things, but man, they look so cool. Then I discovered I didn't leave enough room for the 3.5mm audio jack. No matter what I did, the Pi just wouldn't fit in the case with the speakers plugged in. My initial brilliant plan was to cut off the jack and solder the speaker wires directly to the Pi's test points. If that sounds like a monumentally stupid idea, it's because it was. I'm not sure what possessed me. I mean, it technically worked, but it also sounded like a tin can telephone mixed with radio static. Also, there was an annoying, relentless low hum. I assumed that this was because of the test points, so I soldered the barrel jack back on, and the sound improved dramatically, but the hum was still there. I eventually realized that my circuit design meant I needed to hook up a ground loop isolator to the speakers. I ordered one off of Amazon, chucked it in there, and victory! The hum was gone. For my next project, I'd like to figure out a better solution, but for now, this worked. But now, I was back to the original problem. The board still didn't fit with the audio jack plugged in. Now, I would love to tell you that I did the right thing and redesigned the case. I did not. Nope. I pulled out my rotary tool and went to town. Behold the carnage I inflicted upon this beautifully designed case. Every corner was so thoughtfully designed, and now there's a giant gash inside. You know what? I don't care. Nobody's ever gonna see inside this thing. I'm not winning any awards for aesthetics here, but the Pi does fit now, and that's all that matters. Since Flip-Puck pushes the Pi pretty hard, I added a heat sink and a fan to keep things cool. Also, the screen connects via an SPI connection, which saves space since one cable handles both power and video. Efficiency. Finally, I wanted the volume knob to be accessible, so I created a special cutout for it. I've learned from previous projects that one volume level does not fit all. And with that, the assembly was done. The last thing was to create some cool decals for the sides. I went back to Canva to design these and sublimated them onto sticker paper. I chose to use sublimation because it makes the stickers more resistant to fading, wear, and water. The process is pretty simple. Just print them out on the sublimation printer, transfer the design using a heat press, and cut them out using my very manly pink camo silhouette machine. Yes, it's pink. Yes, it's camo. And yes, it was on sale. What can I say? Real men use pink tools. With the stickers cut out, the last step was to slap them on. They fit like a glove and really bring the whole piece together. I do wish that they lit up somehow. Maybe I'll look into that for the next project. And that's the story of Flip Puck, my love letter to arcades, code, and chaotic plastic pucks. It's loud, it's weird, and it's mine. I couldn't be happier of how this thing came out. It's so cool, and I love watching people experience it for the first time. Before I close this out with a final reveal, I want to quickly tell you about the Inator Club. I have tons of stuff that I just can't fit inside a YouTube video. That's where the Inator Club comes in. Once a month, you'll get a thoughtful email from me. I'll share stuff I've been working on, what's coming up, and a small slice of life from everyone's second favorite mad scientist. Props to Dr. Doofenshmirtz. This is what I do instead of social media, so if you want to stay up to date with me, the Inator Club is where it's at. You can join for free at the link below. And now for the moment you've been waiting for. It is my distinct pleasure to introduce you to Flip Puck.
Like, subscribe. Lots of laughs I promise to provide. The best thing that you ever will decide. Just like, subscribe.
Flip Puck took my game to the next level.